Yeah, hello students. My voice is coming.
My voice is...
Yes, sir.
Okay, so till now 50 students almost. Give a last message. So I'll start. Look at this. This is the syllabus, okay, and this is module 4 portion. I will start today this module 4, okay. And yesterday I had shared 3 books with you, okay, remember? And please keep pay attention to these. The first one is Kang, we all know about this, okay. Then second one is Deva Prasad Das, Real Estate Design. And third one was Rabe, Digital Integrated Circuits. And I have also mentioned which module to refer from which book. Module 1 and 2 from Kang, module 3 from Rabe, and module 4 and 5 from Das. Okay. So make sure that you follow this thing. It will be easier for you to. And module 3 can also be referred from Das. Okay. The portions are there in Das also. So see which book, whichever book you find easier to go with. Okay. And then I had shared you one question paper sample, actually question paper from November 19 end semester. For module 1, 2, and 3. Okay. Chalo, let's start today. So this is the portion that we'll be covering today. Okay. Module 4. It starts with timing analysis. Okay. So I will take this portion from this book, Das. Okay. This is the book. Real Design, second edition from Deva Prasad Das. Okay. So when we go, and to the contents. Chapter 10 is about timing analysis. Okay. Page 307. Okay. So I will go with the book. I have not prepared any separate slides. So look at this timing analysis, chapter 10 from the book Das. The syllabus is following these topics. Okay, the flow is same. So I will be highlighting the important points, important lines in the book. Okay, so as the name suggests, timing analysis, it attempts to perform some analysis which are important from timing point of view for any circuit. Okay, and there are some methods which can be used to analyze a circuit theoretically. Okay, and remember in previous classes we had seen one method that was Elmore delay. Okay, so that method was particularly useful for finding delay in an interconnect, okay, in a wire, right? Similarly, we have methods with which we can obtain delay for different types of circuits, for different types of gates. Okay, So delay in any system, delay in VLSI circuit, we know that delay is the one of the important parameters among the three, and the three parameters were delay, area, and power, right? So like I have highlighted this point, in all VLSI circuits, okay, the input signals pass through the circuit and reach the output, right? So while passing through the circuit, the signals traverse through two components. One is devices and the other is interconnects. We are aware of this. In any circuit, we will have some devices or components like transistors, okay, and we will have interconnects or the wires. Okay, any circuit will consist of these two things, these two components, right? So, and each of these are having their own delay. Okay, devices are having their own delay and interconnects are having their own delay. And one of the method to find out a delay in a interconnect was Elmore delay method that we had seen. Similarly, the response time of a logic gate, if we refer to a particular logic gate, okay, what is the response time? What is the delay time for this particular gate will be called as its this gate delay. Okay, the interconnects are nothing but wires to transmit signals from one point to another point in a circuit. This is also clear. Interconnects are wires which are connecting different nodes in a circuit, right? And they have their own parasitic capacitances and resistances which contribute in the delay part. So the delay component, look at this. The delay component, total delay component, consists of two parameters. One is gate delay, okay, plus the summation of all interconnect or wire delay. This should be clear for any circuit. This is applicable. Okay. So let us see one example. Delay in a CMOS inverter. Delay in a CMOS inverter. Right. So this is the circuit. This is the circuit that we know, that we are already aware of this. Let me make it big. Okay. So again, like this is NMOS, this is PMOS, okay, the VDD and ground, input voltage applied at the gate terminals, and this is the output. This is the output voltage. Okay. But what are these? WYLN and WYLP. The WYL parameter is WYL ratio or width by length of that particular device. The width of the gate by the length of the gate, okay, for NMOSFET. Since this is NMOS device, so this is WYL for NMOSFET. And basically this WYL refers to the size of a gate. Okay, more is the value of WL, bigger is the size of that particular device. Straightforward. Okay, similarly, we can refer to the size of a PMOSFET by WL with a subscript P. Right? Clear? Now, I will be going fast here because we don't have time, much time. So, pay your attention, utmost attention. So, let's say when input voltage is 0 volts, we know that when input is 0, PMOS is on, so, and it will offer some resistance, let it be RP, and NMOS will be off, NMOS will not work, right? This NMOS will not work, okay? So the output capacitance, let it be CL, load capacitance, is connected to VDD via this RP. Or we can also say that the output capacitance, load capacitance, will charge to VDD via this path, okay, which has a resistance of RP, okay, this path, this one, okay, and this will charge CL to VDD, and output voltage will appear to be high, or logic one, clear? Similarly, when input is high, when input is logic one, or when input is VDD, okay, PMOS is off, so this is shown in dotted lines, dashed lines, and NMOS is on, so it will have its own resistance, let it be Rn. And the charge that load capacitor acquired in the previous state will lose, will be discharged via this path, okay, via this Rn, right? I hope this operation is clear. Okay. Any doubts from here? Okay. Now, this from experiments, and they have found out that the resistance value Rp can be expressed by this term. 1 by mu p C oxide times VGS minus mod of VTP minus VDS times L by WP. There, these terms are visible, understood. Mu p is mobility, C oxide is oxide capacitance, VGS is gate source of voltage, VTP is the threshold voltage for P MOSFET, VDS, and then L by W for P MOSFET. Okay, right. And similarly, the expression for Rn is given by this equation. The resistance offered by N MOSFET device, 1 by mu n C oxide, VGS minus VTN minus VDS by into L by W for N. The expressions are similar. You will find a difference for these terms, mu n, mobility for N MOSFET here, VTN, the threshold voltage for N MOSFET. There it was VTP mod. Okay, these values will change, and hence the resistance of these N MOSFET and P MOSFET will also be different, a little bit different. Okay, so let us take the first case when input makes high to low transition. Input V in high to low, that input is going from 1 to 0. Basically, input is going down, input is becoming zero. Now, when remember, when input goes from high to low, that when input is zero, which device is on? PMOS is on, and the charging of load capacitance will occur, right? So when input makes high to low transition, the load capacitor CL charges through the PMOS transistor as shown in figure 10.1b we had just seen, right? Now, during the charging of load capacitor, the output voltage is related to the input voltage according to this relation. Again, this relation is might be familiar to you from your previous courses. Remember from NAS, network synthesis. Okay, V out is equal to V in times 1 minus E minus T by RPCL, where RPCL is the time constant of that particular circuit, right? This is the general equation that we are aware of it. Okay. Now let us now calculate the delay between the input and output waveform. Okay. Considering a 50% trip point, we know that the delay is calculated between the 50% level of input and output voltage. Okay, the time difference. The time, let T1 be at which V out is equal to V in by 2. Then we can write that V out is equal to V in by 2. Okay. And V out is this one. So put equate it to this. So V in by 2 becomes equal to V in times 1 minus E minus T 1 by RPCL. V in will get cancelled. Okay, you will be left with this equation. And from here, we can find out the value of T1, this one, that is equal to 0.69 times RP TCL. Okay. This equation gives the expression for time delay for the output low to high transition. Okay, TPLH. Okay, remember we had also derived an equation for tau PHL and tau PLH, right? Okay. And let us now calculate the rise time of this output waveform, which is defined as the time difference between 20% and 80%. Now there are two more parameters called as rise time and fall time. Okay. I think I had given some questions, homework questions based on this. So suppose the waveform is rising from zero voltage to 5 voltage, let's say. Okay, zero voltage to 5 voltage. So by definition, rise time will be the time that it takes to rise from 20% of 5 voltage, that is 1 volt, to 80%, that is 4 voltage. That time difference, it will not take from 0 to 5 voltage. By definition, it will take from 20% to 80% time difference. And in some books, you will find that this is from 10% to 90%. Okay, so this depends on the definition. So the time that it takes to rise from 20% to 80% is the rise time, and the time that it takes to fall from 80% to 20% is fall time. Again, this can be found out by the same approach, where V out is equal to 20% of V in, 20% of V in. Okay, equate it with that equation, and you will get the expression for rise time like this. That is 1.3863 times RPCL. Okay, rise time, because output is going from low to high, because input was going from high to low. Okay, similarly, the second case, when input makes low to high transition, that input is going from low to high, 0 to 1. So output will go from high to low. Output will discharge. Okay, and this is the equation for discharging capacitance, that V out is equal to V in times e to the power minus t by RNCL. Okay, known equation, right? Again, by definition, the delay is calculated between 50% tip points. So let us assume that T4 be the time at which V out is equal to V in by 2, 50%. And we can write this equation, that V out is equal to V in by 2, and that is equal to actually this V in times e power minus T4 by RNCL. So from here, we find that T4 is equal to 0.69 RNCL. The propagation delay when output falls from high to low. Okay, so this is the fall time. This is the time. This is the time, delay time for the circuit when input was going to high. Input was going to 1. Okay. For previous case, we had T1 as 0.69, and for this case also we had T4 as 0.69 times RNC, but there is a difference. There it was RPCL, and here it is RNCL. So the values will not come same. It will depend on the value of resistance of the device, and RN will be different from RP. Okay. So although the expression looks same, but the value, actual value, will not be same. And similarly, we can find out the fall time, which is from 80% to 20%. Okay, so 80%. Equate, use again those equations to find out T fall. Okay. So one case it will be 80%, and for other case it will be 20%. Okay, and then subtract these two, and you will find an expression that fall time is 1.38663 times RnCl. Okay, this is fine, but I'm more interested in this, the T4 and T1, the tau PLH and tau PHL. Okay, so we had got very simple equations for the tau PLH and tau PHL for a CMOS inverter, assuming that Rn is the resistance offered by NMOS device and Rp was the resistance offered by PMOS device. Okay, the derivation were small, simple, so it should not be any confusion here. If there is any confusion, tell me, you can ask me at that point. Okay, second topic is slew balancing. But what is slew actually? A slew is defined by the rise and fall times of the input and output waveform is often called slew. So the rise time, that it Ohm's time, that is take from reaching 20% to 80% is rise time, and the fall time is the time difference between 80% to 20%, that is fall time. Okay, so they are called generally slew in general terms. Okay, so and we would like to have a circuit which has equal slews, equal rise and fall times. Okay, and the method of making this is called as slew balancing. Right, we know that the RP resistance, the resistance of PMOS, was given by this equation, and RN was from this equation, and we saw that if we want to make the things equal, then we should have RP and RN should be equal. Okay, we should have equal values for RP and RL. So if we equate RP and RN, okay, we get this equation. Okay, relation, that is mu n C oxide times VGS minus VTN by minus VDS by mu P C oxide times VGS minus VTP minus VDS is equal to WL for P by WL for N. Okay, and VGS is equal to Vin minus VDD, VDS is equal to V out minus VDD. This can be found out from the circuit easily, and similarly this one. Okay, and when we put up these condition in this equation, okay, use these condition in that equation, we'll find out that WLP by WL for N is equal to mu N by mu P. And remember this equation. We also found out the same equation when we were actually analyzing CMOS inverter, and we were trying to have an equation or condition for a symmetric CMOS inverter. So this was the condition for a symmetric CMOS inverter also, if you remember. Same condition is coming here also. So in order to have a balanced slew, or in order to have equal values for tau PHL and tau PHL, this condition should be satisfied. Okay. And we know that typically mu n by mu p is equal to 2.5. That is, the mobility of electrons is approximately 2.5 times higher than mobility of holes. Since the WL ratio for PMOS transistor is 2.5 times the WL ratio for NMOS transistor. Okay. So if we use this condition and put up these values in the equation, we can have a circuit which is having equal low to high and high to low delay. Okay. For a particular technology, the channel length is same for both PMOS and NMOS. Remember, just a minute. Hello. अरे अभी क्लास चल रहा है, कॉल करते हैं थोड़ी देर में, ठीक है? Okay. So I had already told you that the length is generally same for all types of devices. What differs is the width. Okay, the width of the device. So the designers must not change the channel length of the PMOS and NMOS transistor. Okay. And in order to make WL ratio of PMOS transistor 2.5 times than that of NMOS transistor, the channel width of the PMOS transistor is kept 2.5 times larger than the channel width of the NMOS transistor. So what is to be changed is only the width of the transistor, not the length. Okay, remember this thing. Next topic is transistor equivalency. So yeah, this is again very important. So how to represent and suppose you find that for example in your circuit analysis that if there are more resistors in series, what is the equivalent resistance, right? And if the resistances are in parallel, what is the equivalent resistances? Similarly, what would be an equivalent transistor if the transistors, if there are many transistors connected in some fashion? So first case, when let's say when the two transistors are in connected in parallel, look at this circuit. Okay, look at this. Here we have this is one NMOS transistor connected with one more NMOS transistor in parallel. So this is the input voltage for this NMOS transistor. This is the gate voltage for this NMOS transistor. M1 is the first NMOS transistor. M2 is second NMOS transistor connected in parallel. Okay, so we should know that if there are two transistors connected in parallel, what could be, and if I want to replace it by a single transistor, okay, some M3, then what should be the changes that we should take care of? Okay, let W1 by L is the WL ratio for M1, and W2 by L is for M2. Remember, L is same, length is same, only width is changing. So this is W1 by L, this is W2 by L. Okay, now these two are in parallel. Okay, so current ID will divide. Okay, ID1 is flowing through M1 and ID2 is flowing through M2, right? And this is the total current ID. So if we want to replace these two transistors with a third transistor, M3, okay, the total current should be remaining same. ID should flow through this M3, same ID. Okay, the total current should be same. Okay, now so let ID1 and ID2 be the currents through the NMOS transistors M1 and M2. Okay, then we can write, we know the equations for ID1. Okay, let these be in linear mode. So mu n C oxide by 2 W1 by L 2 VGS minus VTN times VDS minus VDS square. Expression for ID1. Similarly, expression for ID2 will be like this. Okay, the equations are known. Okay, we have derived these equations. Now ID is the summation of these two, ID1 plus ID2. So let us add these. The total current will come out to be this one. Mu n C oxide by 2 W, look at here, W1 plus W2 by L times VGS minus VTN minus into VDS minus VDS square. Okay, now if the current is same, we have added those two currents and we are finding that we have found out an expression for ID. And here it says that W1 plus W2, look at this term, W1 plus W2, which becomes W equivalent. Okay, so the thing is here that the thing that we are looking, that what should be the size of this transistor M3, when we place m1 and m2 in parallel, and we know the size of this m1 and m2, right? And m1 is of size w1 by l, m2 is of size w2 by l, then the value of m3, the size of m3 would be this term, w1 plus w2 by l. Okay, and hence it becomes of size w1 plus w2 by l. Okay, so what is the meaning of this? Can you tell me? I have a question here. Look at the size of these three transistors, M1, M2, and M3. Which transistor is of biggest size? Can you tell me? M1, M2, or M3? Which is largest? Which transistor? Anyone? Which transistor is largest here? M1 is W1 by L size, M2 is W2 by L, and M3 is of size W1 plus W2 by L. Yes. Any student? Which transistor is biggest? Akansha? Hello. Then Meka is here.
Yes, sir. M3.
M3. Yes. Why? Sir. Why M3?
Sir, the width of the M3 transistor is W1 plus W2.
Yeah. Right. Correct. Okay. The width of the transistor M3 is W1 plus W2. Okay, so it is biggest in size as compared to, like, among these three. Okay, right, this is clear. Okay, and this is the derivation. So this is how we know that how to represent two NMOS transistors in parallel by a single transistor. Okay, so we will go by the current. We will take into account the derivation is coming from the current equations, remember. Okay. And the current that is flowing through these transistors, ID, the total current should be same, right? And this point was used to derive the size of the equivalent transistor, right? So we can see from equation 10.19 that current ID, which is the sum of currents ID1 and ID2, can be obtained by an equivalent NMOS transistor having channel width this. So the equivalent width of the equivalent transistor is W1 plus W2 when two transistors are in parallel. Okay. Hence, two transistors having identical channel length connected in parallel are equivalent to a single transistor of channel width equal to the sum of width of the transistors. So, same thing. Clear? Now, what happens when the two transistors are in series? Okay, so this is the case. Look at this diagram first. This is M1 and NMOS transistor having size W1 by L. Okay, and this is M2 having size W2 by L. They are connected in series. They are having their own input voltages. Okay. And this is the total current ID. Since they are connected in series, so ID will be equal to ID2, will be equal to ID1, right? Okay. If I want to replace this total connection by a single transistor, then what should be the size of this transistor? What should be the value of this W equivalent? Remember, always the length would be same, only the width will change. The width will determine the size of the transistor. Any transistor. So let us see. ID1 is given by this equation. We know ID2 is the current flowing through this M2. This equation very well known. In this case, all the currents are same. ID1 is equal to ID2 is equal to ID, right? And we have these equations from the circuit. Again, can be easily verified. Okay. Now, using these conditions, we can write this equation, equate ID1 is equal to ID2, and substitute those conditions, and you will find that ID comes out to be mu n C oxide by 2 times W equivalent by L to VGS minus VTN, this term, okay. And where W equivalent will come out to be W1, W2 by W1 plus W2, or 1 by W1 plus 1 by W2. Okay, you'll find this. So the size of this transistor, W equivalent, will be given by this term. This term. W equivalent is 1 by W1 plus 1 by W2. Okay. Now you can relate it by when the resistances are in series or capacitances are in series, what was the formula? So you can relate it with those. Okay. But remember, what is the thing that is to be taken care for the derivation? From derivation point of view, use the current values to derive these equivalent sizes. Okay. So two transistors having identical channel length when connected in series are equivalent to a single transistor of channel width W equivalent. Okay. And the value of equation for this W equivalent is this one, 1 by W1 plus 1 by W2. And equal to the reciprocal of the sum of the reciprocal of the width of the transistors, right? Now, can you give me a hint? Can you an idea that which one that this W equivalent would be bigger or smaller than these individual transistors M1 and M2? What do you think?
So smaller.
Smaller? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, look at this equation. W1 plus W2 by W1 plus W1, W2 by W1 plus W2. Smaller? Is it the same equation that we use to calculate resistances when they are in parallel?
Yes, sir.
Same?
Yes, sir.
Acha. Okay, so let's say if W1 is 5, W2 is 10, it becomes 5 times 10, 50 by 15. 3 point, yeah, it will be small, right? Okay, so we found out how to find out an equivalent size transistor when we have two or more transistors. Similarly, we can extend this concept to more number of transistors, okay, more than two. So when the transistors are connected in series or in parallel, okay. So this topic is clear. Any doubts from here? Yeah. And this. So keeping in mind those points, let's just try to design a two input NAND gate for equal rise and fall slew. So whenever we say that design of a gate, it means that to find out the size of the transistors which will be used. Okay, that is W by L ratio. Condition is that we need to have equal rise and fall time. So it's a two input NAND gate. This is the inverter and this is the circuit for two input NAND gate. Okay, now we know the condition for equal rise and fall times for a CMOS inverter. We know that thing. We have just seen in the previous topics. Okay, so we will use that condition for inverter, okay, to derive the size for a CMOS, any other gate, let's say CMOS two input NAND gate. We know about inverter, and we will use this knowledge to design a two input NAND gate. Okay, we will not derive the whole thing for a NAND gate in a separate manner. Okay, rather we will use our current knowledge to derive the size, to find out the size of the gate, because we know almost everything about inverter, right? So to design any complex logic CMOS circuit, we must make the effective resistance of pull-up network and pull-down network equal. Okay, remember, for CMOS inverter, we found out that the size of NMOS should be 1 and the size of PMOS should be, let's say, 2. Actually, it should be 2.5, but for simplicity, it is 2. The size of PMOS should be twice than the size of NMOS for equal slew times, or equal rise and fall slew. This is the thing that is given here. Always, the size of PMOS should be twice than the size of NMOS for having equal propagation delay times, for equal tau PHL and equal tau PLH. Okay. The thing here, the concept that we have just studied will come into picture here. You get here. This is pull down network, and this is the pull down network for the NAND gate, right? And look at, compare the pull down networks of inverter and NAND gate, and compare the pull down network for PMOS and CMOS inverter and NAND gate. Okay, we should make the resistance of pull down networks of NAND gate and inverter equal. Similarly, the resistance of pull up network of NAND gate and CMOS to be equal. That's it. That will give us the size of the gates, size of the transistors that we will use for NAND gate design. Okay. We know that for pull-down network of CMOS inverter, the size is 1. And for pull-up network for CMOS inverter, the size is 2. Okay. Now look at here. The pull-down network of NAND gate consists of two NMOS transistors. Okay, let's say and these two transistors are connected in series. Okay, so this becomes that same problem that we have just solved. If two transistors are in series, and this is the equivalent transistor, but here the problem is reversed. That is, the equivalent transistor size is given, and we have to find out the size of the two transistors which are in series. Okay, separate the problem. This is just for pull down network, because we know that either pull down network or pull up network is available for any operation. There is no condition when pull down network and pull up network both are on. Either pull up network will be on or pull down network will be on. Okay. So here the equivalent transistor size is given out to be 1, and there are two transistors in series in pull down network. Okay, so what should be the size of these two transistors which are in series? Yeah. We have just seen that when the for series transistor case, the equivalent transistor size was equal to W equivalent, that was equal to W1 plus W2, right? But look at here. If we apply that formula here, it should be 4, because here they have written 2 and 2. So this should be equal to 4 actually, but it is not so. Let us see why it is not so. Okay. Okay, it was for a parallel, right? For series, we will use this condition. Na? W equivalent is equal to 1 by W1 plus W2. Sorry, I forgot. Yeah. So this W equivalent is given as 1. And let's say this is W1 and this is W2. Okay. And let us assume that these two transistors are of equal size. Use that, we can use that equation that W equivalent was equal to W1, W2 by W1 plus W2. Okay. And from there, you'll find that the size of these two transistors will come out to be double the size of this equivalent transistor. Okay. Look at this. This formula is applied here. 1 by 1 by x plus 1 by x equal to 1. This gives us x is equal to 2. Okay. So the size of these two transistors in series in pull-down network should be 2. Because we are relating it with the pull-down network of CMOS inverter. Okay. So this is clear. The size of NMOS transistors should be 2. For pull-down network. What about pull-up network? The PMOS transistor is size 2 for a CMOS inverter. What should be the size of these PMOS transistors in pull-up network? We know that when the transistors are in parallel, the size gets added up. Right? We had just seen W equivalent was W1 plus W2 for parallel connections. So it should be 4 here. It should be 4. Or it should have been 1 here. 1 and 1. This should have been 1 and 1 here. But why it is 2 and 2? Look at here. Because the transistors PMOS are connected in parallel. Okay. There is one important point here. We will consider the worst condition that is available. Okay. Now the output Y is connected to VDD via this pull-up network, via these PMOS transistors. Okay. And they are in parallel. So either one of them would be on, A will be on this, this is on, okay. This is off, or B is on, A is off, or both are on. Okay. So what is the worst condition? What is the worst condition? When both of these PMOS transistors are on, the output is connected to VDD and both are contributing equally. Both are bearing the load current. Okay, so the current will divide. That is not the worst condition. The worst condition is when one of them is on and the other one is off. Then the whole load current will come on to that particular transistor, PMOS transistor, which is on. That is the worst condition, right? So in that case, one transistor is on and one is off. So basically we are having just one transistor for the worst case condition. And that is why the size of these transistors are equal to the size of this inverter PMOS transistor. Okay. Clear? And this is what being explained here. You go through this section and you will know. Right. Similarly, two input NOR gate. So look at here. Okay, let me go make it big. Okay. So this is the inverter that we know, and we know the size. PMOS is twice the size of NMOS. Okay. And this is the two input NOR gate. Okay, and this is, there is a mistake here. There should be NMOS transistors. In the pull-down network, there should be NMOS transistors, not PMOS. This is a small mistake. So we have two NMOS transistors in parallel and two PMOS transistors in series. Okay, now let us go. Let us start with pull-down network. Okay, for pull-down network, the size is 1 for inverter. Then this is the equivalent size. And NMOS transistors are in parallel for this pull-down network. Okay. two NMOS are in parallel. So what is the worst condition? The worst condition is when one of the transistor is on and the other one is off. So only that particular transistor will bear the complete current. Okay. So when one is on, it means that there is just one transistor, so which should be equal to the size of this NMOS. So the size of these two transistors are 1 and 1 because they are in parallel. Similarly, look at the pull-up network, two PMOS transistors. The equivalent transistor is given as 2. Okay. So what should be the size of these two PMOS transistors when they are connected in series? Again, by using that same logic, the worst condition is what? Look, when one of them is on, the other one is off, obviously there will be no current. The current will flow only when both of them are on. So we will have to consider the case when two transistors are connected in series. You apply that formula, you will get the size of these two transistors should be 4. Double the size of these two, this PMOS transistor. Okay, 4 and 4. So for a CMOS two input NOR gate, the size of NMOS transistor should be 1 and 1. The size of PMOS transistor will be 4 and 4. Okay. Are you getting this? We are getting the size of these transistors, pull-up network and pull-down network, by comparing it with the size of CMOS inverter, pull-up network and pull-down network. Right? This should be clear. So this is the thing that is being explained in this section. Okay. So there is an example here. So design a 3-input NAND gate with a transistor width such that the effective rise and fall time, fall resistances are equal to that of an inverter. 3-input. Now this you go through this example. That is the case for a 3-input NAND gate. 3-input NAND gate. Okay. So what do we expect? Pull-down network, 3 NMOS transistors in series. So all of these should be on. So the size becomes thrice. Okay. Pull-up network, the transistors are in parallel. So worst condition is one of them is on, the other two are off. So that particular transistor should be of same size for this PMOS transistor for inverter, right? But you should show that equations and derivations. Okay, how we are, what is the equivalent size W formula for series and parallel cases? So you should use that equivalent size formula along with the worst case condition. Remember, the worst case application is important, and then you decide whether to use equivalent W formula or not. Okay. Similarly, this is the case. Go through this. Example 10.2. Okay. Right? Okay. So this is how we can calculate the size of the transistors for any gate, any circuit, by looking at the size of inverter. Okay. And this is very important, again, from design point of view. Very important. Okay. Then in your syllabus, what is the next topic? Transistor size on propagation delay. Inverter sizing effect on propagation delay. Yeah, this one. So I will give this topic to as an exam, as a homework. So you will read this section 10.14 from this book. Okay, read this section from the book. Inverter sizing effect on propagation delay. Okay. And yeah, there is one more very important topic, which is this logical effort. लॉजिकल एफर्ट, या 10.18 लॉजिकल एफर्ट। ओके, सो इट इज अगेन मेथड टू estimate the delay of the circuits, CMOS circuits, first introduced in 1999 by Sutherland et al. And other authors. Okay, Sutherland and other authors. So I will come to the formula directly. The delay of a circuit, let's say minimum size inverter, okay, is given by this equation according to this logical effort concept, that D is equal to P plus G into H. Okay, P plus G into H, P plus G into H, where H is equal to C out by C in, look at this, and G is equal to C in by C inverter. The term P is called the parasitic delay. The term P is the parasitic delay. It is given by the intrinsic delay of the gate, that is the gate that we are working on, by the intrinsic delay of the minimum size inverter. Okay. H is known as the electrical effort, given by C out by C in, as is visible from this equation, H is C out by C in. Okay. And G is known as the logical effort, is given by this formula, C in by C inverter. Again, the same thing will apply here, that if we are calculating delay for any particular circuit, okay, then it will be calculated with respect to a minimum size inverter. In the whole library, there will be a inverter, there will be an inverter in the standard library, which is of minimum size, which is of the smallest size. And we assume that that particular inverter is a minimum size inverter. And all other gates are having their delays with respect to that particular inverter, so that it becomes easier to calculate the delay for a particular, for a given big complex circuit. Okay, the logical effort, which is given by this G, C in by C inverter. C in inverter is the capacitance of the inverter, and C is the input capacitance of that particular gate that we are calculating. This logical effort is the ratio between the input capacitance of the gate and the input capacitance of the minimum size inverter. This invert C in the denominator is input capacitors of minimum size inverter. Okay, so it basically represents how much worse a gate is than a minimum size inverter in driving the same output current. Okay, suppose it is compared with respect to a minimum size inverter, any circuit. Okay. Now, what happens is that we have to deliver some current at the output terminal. Okay, so how much effort has the particular gate has to do, has to apply in delivering that output current to that part with respect to minimum size inverter in driving the same output current. Okay, so it is basically a comparison, that how much effort a particular gate does with respect to the minimum size inverter. Okay, So logical effort is very important in designing the logic cells, as it depends only on the circuit topology. It only depends on the kind of connections, the way in we connect the components. Okay. So hence designers can select alternative topologies for implementing the same logic functions and check for minimum logic effort to produce the. So the gates connected in a particular fashion may be having less logical effort than the gates connected in a different logical function, different topologies. So here, how the connections are made, that is important. Okay. So here, inverter is given. This inverter, we know, this is two input NAND gate. This is two input NOR gate, right? Now, by using this logical effort concept, we can determine the size of these transistors. Okay. And the size we have already found out now in the previous section. We have to find out the logical effort, right? Now, the logical effort for inverter, logical effort for inputs of static gates, assuming gamma equals to 2. Okay. So this is the table that shows us the logical effort for different gates. For input, for inverter, the logical effort is 1. The number of input is 1, obviously, we know. For two input NAND gate, the logical effort is 4/3. Okay. So, and for two input NOR gate, the logical effort is 5/3. Look at this. This NAND gate is 4/3. Logical effort for NOR is 5/3. So for the same number of input, okay, the NAND gate and NOR gate are having different logical effort. NOR gate is having higher logical effort than NAND gate. And the multiplexer is having 2 logical effort. XOR is having 4 logical effort. So from these terms, we can think that out of these 4 circuits, let's say NAND, NOR, multiplexer, and XOR gate, okay, out of these 4 circuits, which is having the highest amount of effort, and which is having lowest? Obviously, XOR gate have to put most amount of effort, and NAND gate is having least amount of effort, 4/3. Okay, and we want to minimize this logical effort. Remember that aim is to minimize logical effort for any particular circuit. The general formula is like this, the last column. Okay. And if we look at this equation, D is equal to P plus GH. Okay, G was logical effort. Okay, this is the complete equation for delay. P parasitics, G logical, H electrical. If you look at the whole equation, and if we plot D versus H, okay, then for inverter, this line is for inverter, where G is 1 and P is equal to 1. So it starts at an intercept of 1 and then having a linear slope, linear line, the slope is 1. For a 2-input NAND gate, G is equal to 4/3 and P is equal to 2. It starts with 2 and having the slope. So graphically, it shows that NAND gate have to put more effort. Obviously, the inverter will be having the least effort. in any circuit, in any library, because all things are derived with respect to that particular inverter. So all other gates will be having higher effort with, as compared to inverter. Okay. So this formula is important. D is equal to P plus G H, and they're individual. What is P? What is H? What is G? Right. And this table is also important. So what are the logical effort for particular gates? Two input NAND gate, NOR gate, multiplexer, XOR gate, and the general formula. Okay, and the thing is that we want to reduce the logical effort because we want to reduce delay. So we want to have a circuit which is having least amount of logical effort. And what is the least value of logical effort? It is for an inverter, and value is equal to 1. The value is equal to 1. Okay. So this is the topic for logical effort. So with this, you know, this portion is complete, module 4. This portion is complete. Right. Okay. So let me stop here. I'll stop because the portion is there. It will take some time for this topic also, and VLSI testing also. Okay. It is not possible to cover these top three topics in one. It will be very hectic. BiCMOS technology and VLSI testing. Okay. So I will ask you that what to do. Should we conduct other classes, or I will record these lectures and upload and you will watch? What will be better for you? You tell me. Because these two important, these topics are important. This BiCMOS portion and this VLSI testing. You will always find questions based on this test. Write a note on ad hoc testing, or write a note on scan test, write a note on VST, building self test, what are different fault models, what is the fault simulation. These are theoretical, so theoretical notes type of questions will come from VLSI testing. So what should I do? Should I record the lectures and upload? Or
sir, record the lectures and upload.
Yeah, other students, what will be better? And the last portion, that is digital design using Verilog, because you have done Verilog in your lab. You have already designed various circuits and using Verilog lab, so it will be easier for you. Okay. You are very well aware of the language. So this is again given in that same book, DAS. So introduction and various conventions, various operators in Verilog, various data types, and what is behavioral modeling, structural modeling, and combinational and sequential circuits. All these things were covered in the lab. Okay. So I am actually assuming that you will cover this portion by your own. I will give you some resources where you can put this portion, okay, for Verilog. But it will be easier for you because you have done this. Yeah, other students, please respond what to do for these portions. I can either take extra classes, or I can also record the lectures and upload. You tell me. Respond.
Sir, recording, sir.
Acha, okay. Pravash is here.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Pravash, what do you think?
Recording, sir.
Recording?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I can record and upload, but there is a student. Recording and uploading is fine, but whether you will watch those videos or not, that's important. Okay, so make sure that you watch those videos, because studying on your own is fine, but if you watch the video once and then you study, then you get some more, you get more points. It becomes easier to, you know, go through those. So I will either record or will tell you the source. Okay, you can follow those things, sources, resources, lectures. And once you go through those resources, then you go to these topics in the book. It will be very easy for you, right? This VLSI testing is a complete theoretical part. So just have to read it like a story. And by CMOS technology is again simple, because if we have done for CMOS technology, CMOS circuit, we have seen many circuits. Okay, similarly, designing circuit in BiCMOS technology is a similar thing, and again easy because we have done CMOS earlier. Okay, so this thing, I will tell you what to do. Okay, so tell me about from today's class. Yeah, no doubts. Anything? Can we cover this portion, BiCMOS technology? It will take just not.
Sir, so now actually we have an class of industrial electronics.
Class, what time?
Sir, at 12. It's already been started.
12:10. Okay. ठीक है. Okay. I will stop.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. चलो.
Sir.